So we'll get started.
Okey-doke.
Thank you for coming out to the Developer Day today on a Saturday. We really appreciate you making it out. Was that sarcastic or is that genuine enthusiasm?
Yay, Saturday, away from the family, hooray!
Yay, go Paul! Well, we really wanted to accommodate as many people as possible, and as we talked to people, the preference was definitely for Saturday, so I hope that was genuine, Rick. I'm Ben Galbraith.
I'm Dion Almaer, and Ben and I have worked together for quite a while in different communities, mainly in the Ajax community where we launched ajaxian.com. And now, of course, we're at Palm.
Yeah, we've been at Palm for a while now. We came here also from Mozilla. And we wanted to spend some time with you this morning before we kicked off the Developer Day and talk about how we view the world here at Palm, talk about our developer program and some of the things that are happening with our platform. And to do that, we wanted to kick off with clicker that doesn't work.
We have to turn it on because it has a thing called batteries inside. And so you have to turn it on.
Something we know nothing about in this community. all right. So as we look out of the marketplace today, we see an explosion of mobile devices. And it's really kind of amazing times when you sit back and think about it.
Yeah, it's really fun. We're at CES and walking around and just, you know, seeing, well, I guess they were big on 3D TVs this year, but in general, just seeing all of the different devices and things that are available. You know, I have these dreams. I always talk to Ben where these glasses will become connected to the internet, and this thing that makes me look like a geek will make me superhuman with a heads-up display that does lots of cool stuff.
Or just a geek with a heads-up display.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. One of those. Yeah. And as a consumer, it's incredibly exciting, right?
Yeah, absolutely. It's like the Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy brought to real life, or Star Trek, or whatever your sci-fi persuasion is. But from a developer perspective, it's not quite as exciting. Because as we look at this diversity of devices and all these possibilities that are out there, that's great. But as we try and target these devices as developers, the fragmentation we're seeing makes it really difficult. Because each of these devices has its own operating system, its own platform, its own developer story. And it really sort of locks out the independent developers from being able to target those platforms, because you really have to be able to economize and have scale to be able to have a Java version of your application or a weird derivative of object-oriented derivative of C or you know, whatever else is out there. And so that really sort of throws cold water on what's possible because of the fragmentation that's out there. We've seen this before in the industry, right? How many Atari ST fans in the audience?
Did the Spectrum come over here? Spectrum 48K?
No, we only had like real computers that could do
okay.
Things.
We had rubber computers, these are actual rubber keys that you would press. It was pretty fun stuff.
Yeah, the microcomputer days, we saw the same thing, right? We saw the same platform fragmentation, and we saw the same pain in the developer community. And that was present up until someone sort of ran away and eventually dominated the marketplace. And once that happened in the microcomputer world, it really prevented other players from breaking in and innovating and providing other alternative operating systems, because the apps marketplace was really sort of locked down. But something changed that.
Yeah, and then we still see it in like the console market and different things. It's still a lot of this stuff is playing out the same way. But I definitely think that the web changed the game here, right? It's because of the web kind of sneaking in this virtual machine really into the game that could run on these different platforms. It changed what mattered actually on the OS of the platform itself. And it's because of that that we got to see all of the great brands and companies of the last 5, 10 years, they all come from the world of the web, and they didn't have to make special business deals with the OS platforms to be able to become what they became become today.
So as we look at the future of devices, at all these devices that are emerging, and we ask ourselves, what as developers, because that's really our background, as developers, how do we want to solve this problem? We actually see something really interesting. We see that all of these platforms, all of the emerging smartphone platforms have amazing web runtimes, regardless of the manufacturer, and many of them actually just use the same runtime. They just use WebKit. And so we look at the web as a great way to combat the device fragmentation that we're seeing in the marketplace today. And that makes sense from a number of perspectives, one of which is just the sheer popularity of the web. There's over 1.5 billion web clients. It's by far the most popular platform in the world, in the history of development. And some browsers are more popular than others, but that's changing rapidly.
Normally there's someone from Opera in the crowd that like complains about, they do an analysis on how large the logos are, and They claim Opera Mobile's huge.
I think it should have another pixel, to be
fair.
There's
two pixels we need to add to that. Yeah.
So the web is amazingly popular as a platform. And that's one of the reasons why we think it makes sense as a solution to mobile fragmentation. But you might ask yourself from a technical perspective, really? Is the web, like yesterday I heard someone say, hey, are you guys ready to concede that JavaScript performance just isn't there and you need to go somewhere else or the web just isn't really? So from a technical perspective, I think there are a lot of people who ask, you know, is the web really the platform that makes sense for this kind of thing? So clearly the web is good at some things.
Yeah, when the web came about, it's all about documents, and it's very easy for us to style and do different things with documents, CSS, et cetera, for laying out things pretty easily for something like the New York Times. And in fact, it was funny, we were at F8 this week, and we were at a session all about 320, which is a framework that Joe Hewitt created to create the Facebook app on iPhone. And he basically recreated the entire, you know, DOM and layout system of the web, because that's where he came from, the Firefox world, and brought that over to the Objective-C world. And he had to recreate it in obviously very different ways, and you're relying on this one implementation. The web is actually really fantastic for doing this type of layout. But we want to do things like this. We wanted to do very, very rich immersive experiences, and games kind of like push the boundaries on what's happening there. That industry tends to do that. But we're seeing this more and more in our actual applications as well. Our apps need to be able to do very rich things, very nice effects, nice user experience. It's incredibly important, and the platform needs to be able to support that for you. Unfortunately, as much as we love CSS and the world of layout, we know it has real limitations, and we're fully aware of that. All of us here actually have to live in that world, and there's definitely issues kind of abound with CSS. And that's actually something that Palm had to solve as we built out our platform and built our apps on top of it.
So as the web has explored going from what it's really good at to becoming a general purpose platform for applications, we're seeing the emergence of a set of technologies that really change the game for the web and what's possible with the web. And a lot of these technologies all sort of band together under one moniker. And kind of have a slide that sort of goes into this. With the magic, I don't know if we've got the audio here. Oh, we had some audio on the slide.
Yeah.
But HTML5 really sort of embodies a bunch of technologies that are designed to take the web to where it needs to be for applications. And 2 or 3 years ago, this was all sort of future-looking things. Well, we got the audio there, kind of. maybe we could play it again with the audio.
Yeah, we've got to do it with the audio. It makes it more.
There it is. Thank you.
It's going to save us all.
With unicorns. Flying unicorns. Do all unicorns? No, I guess it's a special breed of unicorn. So HTML5 represents this set of augmentations to the web that really takes it from being a hypertext platform, an enhanced hypertext platform, to a rich application environment. We wanted to spend a few minutes talking about some of those technologies. But before we do, we have a small clarification. When we talk about HTML5, and when people in the industry talk about HTML5, it turns out there's really kind of two definitions. One definition is this specification that exists in W3C and what the working group, and the way that they sort of co-run that is a little confusing. But there's sort of the spec HTML5, and then there's everything that's happened in web standards since HTML4. And it turns out this is the definition that universally pretty much everyone uses, except for a few pedants here and there. When you hear HTML5, that's the definition that we use as well. And so we wanted to talk a little bit about some of the technologies that are present in mobile, in modern browsers, including mobile browsers, that really excite us about HTML5.
Yeah, so a friend of ours, Ernest Delgado, recently joined the Chrome team over at Google, and he put together this awesome open source slide deck that kind of shows some of the technology that's in HTML5, and you get to use it in real time. So he talks about the history and things like that that we're not going to go into, but then he goes into the technology and the new JS APIs that you have available. I'm going to flip through this pretty quick. All of this stuff is online at apirocks.com, so you'll be able to check it out, including all of the code. we've now got the ability to do things like actually storing things locally through web storage and web databases, and we can just go in and in trivial amounts of code, we can create tables and create to-do lists and have things just work locally. We've got the ability to cache our data and take that offline, so we can run in offline mode, even if we're in the browser. And we have the ability to do things on the background. So we'll be able to do a complicated routing algorithm and have it not block the UI of the application. This is incredibly important to build responsive UIs. We now get that ability as part of HTML5. Sockets, being able to talk back and have real-time commit level systems. We now have that in WebSockets that's just making its way into browsers right now. We have interest in notification support, where you can go through and do kind of cheesy growl-like notifications, and you can set permissions, and it's going to kind of set up if you're allowed to actually do that. We've got rich drag and drop finally, so I can go in and select something, and it can do the right thing. Gmail just added this, where you can just drop files onto Gmail, and it'll just upload them for you. Before, it's always been really painful. Geolocation, we supported this in WebOS before this was a standard and had our way of doing it, but there's now a standard to be able to easily just kind of track what's going on location-wise. And then we have interesting things happening in HTML. We've got these whole new set of semantic tags that allow you to tell more about what's going on, allow the browser to do interesting things when it sees these things. So you can have something that's defined as a footer, defined as a menu, and the browser can do interesting things. You can say, this is type equals email, and the browser can enforce that it's a valid email and the like. A lot of interesting stuff coming on the HTML side. Microdata. A lot of accessibility is still making its way in. This is the new form types. This is really exciting. Stuff that we've had to do in JavaScript for years, we now don't have to do anymore. We can just tell the browser what it is, and the browser can do a smart thing. Over in Mozilla land, they just implemented a new contacts add-on, so you can experiment with this. So if it's type equals email, you start to type an email, and it'll auto-complete for you. So now suddenly, all of your email contacts follow you around the web. So a lot of really cool stuff is happening on that side. We've got HTML5 audio and video, so we don't have to use Flash for everything there, which is great. Yep. We've got Canvas and the ability to do arbitrary drawing, which is really important when you want to kind of craft things the way you want them on the drawing side of things. And we've got really awesome examples. This is something Ernesto did himself. It talks to Flickr and grabs his images, and he manages all of this stuff. And because it's native to the browser, you can just export anything out just as an image, which is cool. We've got WebGL, the ability to do rich 3D games, graphics, and the like, baked in to the browser in a way that it understands it and it can interface with other things that are going on. We'll see a great example of that. And then we have CSS. We have new selectors and new things that that we can arm ourselves on. The ability to have arbitrary fonts is incredibly important as you build something that feels just right. You've got small little things that you've had to do manually in JavaScript and the like to do correctly. You can now do all of this stuff with very simple CSS. We talked about the whole formatting craziness of CSS. There's actually really interesting new primitives to allow you to do layout a lot easier than just the normal kind of box model. And then different effects like stroking, opacities on the fly for both backgrounds and colors, changing the different, this is the favorite Web 2.0 example. We can now do rounded corners. We could even give the users the social ability to change how rounded their corners are. That's how cool this stuff is.
Web 3.0.
Yeah. Gradient support to allow you to do really interesting stuff, right, just from declaring in CSS, shadows to move things around, box shadows on the actual element itself. And now we can just build instant Web 2.0 logo creators right from the web technology itself. Cool stuff with backgrounds, transitions. It just keeps going and going. Just really awesome stuff that we can just build right in. Very, very easy.
Press three.
A few lines
press
of
three.
Code. Should I press three?
What happens?
Ooh. Nice, huh? Yes. Cool stuff.
Completely
gratuitous. Look at that. We can do your own blink tag. right from CSS itself. Make it pulse. No JavaScript required. Yeah. So all of this stuff is available and coming right now. It's an incredibly exciting time to start doing web development, because as Ben said before, we're getting all the stuff that we need for applications, not just documents, and it's all kind of getting slammed on us by all of these great rendering engines and modern browsers that are available. And let's give us kind of like one way to hit that home a little bit.
Browser didn't hang, the video hung.
Yeah. And so we like to talk about games to show off all of this cool stuff that you can do. Again, it's a great way to kind of exemplify that. But we're seeing great things in applications as well. This is someone, Thomas Fuchs, who wrote Scriptaculous. He got a new iPad, and then he played around with it on the weekend. And in 2 hours, he created this little visualization of different time zones using these different CSS effects that we talked about a little bit. Couple of hours, very, very nice, rich motion, things going on. You can create really compelling user experiences using web technologies right now. And of course, we have all of this stuff baked right on.
So I spent a few minutes talking to you about the state of the web platform, just to share with you the enthusiasm that we have for what's happened there. The web has been stagnant for a long time. Ajax came along and sort of taught us to use more of what was just sitting there. And over the past 3 to 4 years, browsers have been seeding in newer technologies that have really sort of changed the game for what's possible on the web. And when we look at the web platform, we see an incredibly compelling application platform. And now that Microsoft has come out and announced that IE9 will embrace HTML5 and the standards we've shown you, it's even more exciting what's possible with this platform. But we've been talking sort of in the abstract of HTML5. We want to bring it now very specifically down to mobile, and what's possible in mobile platforms today, and what's possible on our platform today. For the reasons we talked about as far as mobile fragmentation at Palm, we're really excited about the web because we see that as the opportunity that's most compelling right now for developers to address the market they want to address for developers. But as we thought about how can we take the web and put it into our device, we wanted to figure out where we can add value. And so that's where Mojo fits in. And as we released our developer platform and released Mojo for our applications and for third-party applications, we set out to solve some of the problems that we felt like were gaps with the web, one of which is a rich mobile UI toolkit. And that's one of the strong value adds that Mojo provides, is giving you components that make it really, really easy to use and really easy to create great mobile interfaces. Another gap that we wanted to fill was in web tooling. And that's one of the things that we address with Aries.
Yep, and we just released Aries 1.0 just a week ago at JSConf, and that brings now all of these rich components, all of the services that you have available, nice new high-level things like being able to just grab Google Maps, drag it on, and start building it into your application. Because we leverage the web, we can just get all of this stuff for free. We can just use the Google Maps APIs. You can just start using them. We don't have to go create Palm-specific Google Maps APIs. We can just use the great stuff that's already out there in the web. One of the great things that Aries does, too, is it helps on the layout side of the equation. We all joked about CSS for layout before, and there's some nice new primitives that we're getting. But if you play around with Aries, you'll just see how easy it is using the different layout systems to just give you exactly what you want when you're building an application, especially on a constrained screen. As well as announcing version 1 of Aries, yesterday, Steve Lemke on the tools team showed off for the people that were here the Aries debugger. So this, for those that weren't here, is a standalone debugger for V8. So you don't have to go through Aries and use the full IDE. If you want to just do some debugging, you can just go along to this one standalone area and start debugging your application. Connect to the phone. You can do a search for your application if you're running it in the emulator or whatever, and you can just start looking at all of the code. It's a great way, frankly, too, to play around with what's going on our existing apps. So now and then I do this. I like, in this case, we've fired up, you know, we can fire up the phone application, we can connect to it, and we can see what's going on, and we can set breakpoints and literally see what these rich apps that Palm have created are doing, and you guys can get inspiration from that. All of the source code from our core applications are made available in the SDK for you to use. We want you guys to look at the applications that we've created. They're obviously production ready, rather than just little samples, so you can kind of gain inspiration from that.
So we think with Mojo and some of the things we've given you in Mojo, we started to fill the holes as far as what you can do with mobile web. And with Aries, we've used the web itself to create some great tools that also fill some gaps in the ecosystem. We wanted to kind of do something in this talk that's a little bit different. First, you know, at the Dev Day yesterday, we talked a lot about sort of an introduction to the platform. And today we've got a lot of sessions that talk to you about the state of the platform today. But what we want to spend a few minutes on is something that we don't typically do here at Palm. We wanted to take a few minutes and kind of give you a glimpse at the future of what's coming. Yeah. And as we do this, it's important to give you a few caveats as we sort of take this journey into the future. One caveat is that we're not going to be very specific about when some of the things we're going to talk to you about are going to land, but they will be here at some point by the fall. And so at some point in the fall, all the technologies we're talking about are going to land, and that's all the specificity we want to put around some of this stuff. But we thought it would be important to take a few minutes and share with you where we're going with the dev platform in some specific technology areas.
Yep, so now we've got into Doctor Who's TARDIS, jump through into the future a little bit, and kind of see what's available in the full area. So we showed a bunch of demos earlier in the HTML5 side of the equation on what you can do with this rich CSS. And we're working really hard on accelerating all of the CSS animations and transitions that you have available on our platform. So that's going to allow you to have these really smooth applications that just feel like they're like butter as the user actually uses them. We're putting a lot of effort to accelerate as much as we can to enable you guys to create these just beautiful applications. Here's one example, the snow stack that will just kind of like really push this home on the desktop, and it's exactly the same technology that we've got on the mobile side.
So this is all accomplished through CSS, and it demonstrates what's possible with hardware-accelerated CSS transforms. And this is all done using the DOM API, so you don't have to go off into some other 3D API to make this possible. And sometimes people wonder, you know, what's the mobile application? Well, when you put this on a mobile device, this is a simulation of the types of things you do, but you create these types of smooth transitions and animations that tend to excite people quite a bit. Someone asked me the other day, you know, on the web, how can we get the web to be fast and smooth? And this is how the web solves that problem. And so this is one of the technologies we're working on to deliver that help you create fluid and amazing transitions. And this stuff is all out there and documented in web standards, and you can take a look at how it works today. But it's one of the really exciting technologies that we're bringing to the SDK.
That example, by the way, was using JQ Touch, which again you can use right now on our platform and play around with.
Really, you want to show this demo, or should we skip this one?
Let's just kick it off quick.
All right.
Another exciting thing about using these different technologies is that you can keep the fact that you've just got simple semantic HTML in your application, and you can do very rich things with that. So here we've got like a movie trailer kind of situation going on, but if we did a view source, this is just the transcript of this particular scene in a movie. So for people with screen readers, they just get to see the transcript, and that's great. Search engines, of course, on the web can crawl this stuff, but we can just go on top of this and put this beautiful display, cinematic display, on top of the simple HTML. Very simple, as you can see.
Very, very simple. So with CSS transforms, it's possible to create amazingly fluid and dynamic user interfaces on mobile. And so that's the piece that it fits, and we're really excited about that. But another piece that is at least as exciting is JavaScript services. So if you look at two different applications on mobile, let's take a look at the mobile Google Maps application, and then let's take a look at the email client that we provide on our platform. You know, on the surface, they kind of seem like they're similar beasts. But when you sort of take a peek under the covers, the way that they get their data is pretty different. The Gmail version just uses HTTP to go to Gmail servers and just grabs all its information. Whereas the mail client version on our platform uses the service bus to use services that actually talks using protocols like IMAP and SMTP, EAS, and POP to go out and get data. Looking at it a different way, webOS applications have a service bus that they use to communicate with services, and the services oftentimes go off and do interesting things to get data and do functionality for the application beyond what you do in the web tier. And the state of the platform right now is that we don't let you create these services. With JavaScript services, we're really excited that we're giving you this capability. And in fact, all of our applications use JavaScript services in the future. We're actually working on this right now. And these services are inspired by technologies like Node.js and CommonJS.
Yeah, it's really exciting. So JavaScript has spread beyond the browser. And now with like the CommonJS movement and then Node.js on the server, we're seeing a lot of energy is being put into, well, JavaScript can run elsewhere. It's a great language, and it could be perfect to run on the server, and you get really interesting advantages if you use JavaScript on client and server. As these guys were working on this stuff, at Palm, we were doing a similar thing. We wanted to allow web developers to build services in the languages that they know and love, like JavaScript. And so when they do that, what do we need to give them? Well, we need to give them file access and these different APIs, the same problems that these guys are trying to solve because JavaScript in the browser doesn't give you access out of the sandbox, we were solving ourselves on the device. This is incredibly exciting. For the first time, a JavaScript guy can now come along, build a service that does things directly on the device. It's on the other side of the service bus. This is awesome. You can now do very rich things on that side that until now only the homebrew community has been able to do. So we're incredibly excited about this.
So specifically, JavaScript services give you background asynchronous services. They also give you a way to do file I/O. thank you. Binary JavaScript types, which is really important for data processing, obviously. Low-level network I/O, and something we're calling medium-level HTTP I/O. So obviously, AJAX and XHR gives you high-level HTTP in the browser, but we're actually exposing something curl-like to give you medium-level HTTP support, much richer support to do HTTP network I/O, but without having to go down to the socket layer and learn the protocol yourself. And finally, for people who are looking for an alternative to JSON for doing different types of data processing, we're putting a fast XML streaming processor into this environment. So this is something like SAX or STAX. It's an alternative to the DOM parser because the DOM parser will actually take your entire XML and parse it into memory, and sometimes it's just not practical. Sometimes you have a large amount of data, and you just want to scan that data for interesting tidbits without having to put everything in memory. As you can imagine, on mobile devices, that can be important.
Yeah. So Rob Chook, he's going to be giving a talk all about this stuff today. So he's going to go through. You can go listen to him. It's TSUK is his last name on the agenda, and he's going to go through kind of the history and what we're doing and all of these APIs. And if there are things that you would like to see added, low-level primitives like these, this is why we're doing this today, is to have this conversation. So we want to give you guys as much as we can for you to build these really rich services. And these services you'll be able to bundle with your application. You could write standalone services. Someone could write a new email provider and just put it in as a service. So we're again, extremely excited to be able to offer this to you guys, to have you be able to write things on the other side of the bus.
I'll talk to you about something else. We want to talk to you about a technology that we call DB8. So as you look at the architecture of a modern web application, especially a modern mobile web application, you have a server that you request data from, and typically that's data in JSON, and you'll get that data and you'll cache it in some way or another locally. And today we have a technology called Mojo Depot for that that sits on top of a SQL database. And we're rolling out something called DB8 that replaces that that data store. And DB8 is a native JSON store. And one of its features is that it's designed to really easily synchronize with these types of data stores in the cloud, CouchDB being the primary example. So you can have a CouchDB store in the cloud, And it gives you primitives that make it really easy to keep that data in sync. Now, how does that actually work? Well, it's got built-in primitives that make it easy for you to see what data's changed, including what data's been deleted. And it makes it really, really easy for you then to synchronize with a similar type of service in the cloud. And it also gives you querying abilities on top of the JSON data. So you're not just shoving JSON into a blob or into a data field. And you don't go through the complexity of having to deconstruct it into a columnar format. You actually have native querying across JSON structures. Another great feature is fine-grained access control. So it makes it really easy for you to say, you know, in this application, I want these types of data exposed to other apps, but this other type of data I don't want exposed. And it gives you a really clean way for sharing across different applications. And one of the other things we love about it is that it's mobile optimized and really, really fast, which obviously is also really important for our use case. These last two points are sort of community points. This is an open source project that we'll be releasing, and it's got a pluggable back end. So you can actually use it in different environments on top of different stores. We're really excited about DB8. So we also have another grab bag of technologies we want to talk to you about for a minute that's coming out that we don't want to spend quite as much time on. First of which is
audio and video recording. So you're going to have the ability from an API to grab into microphone land on the phone and be able to actually record the audio and video that's coming in from the user. So there's a lot of apps on other platforms that use this. We're going to be giving you that ability with a really nice, simple API to get access to these facilities.
I don't actually camera know flash. If camera flash is on there, but for you, sir, yes. We will make sure. We've taken a note. Camera flash. The next thing, media indexers. So this is actually something that reflects sort of our core philosophy. A lot of people have asked us, geez, I want to create a media player, and I want to be able to access the music that's on the device. Right now, we don't have a way for you to do that. Some people kind of wring their hands over this idea because do we really want to have the community creating a bunch of media playing applications? Would we rather restrict that to what we give you? And we obviously really want you to be able to do that. And so that's one of the things we're opening up is the ability for you to get access to the media that's on the device, write your own views and your own applications on top of it. And so we're excited about that.
So yesterday, some of you may have seen Brian Hernacki giving a little bit of a talk on the PDK sandbox. As part of that, we're giving you crypto primitives in a secure key manager, so you can manage, you know, the licensing side of things and just crypto needs that you have in your application. All of this stuff is going to be available for you. So all of the typical usual suspects in crypto are going to be there for you to use in your applications.
But not just in the PDK.
Not just in the PDK. No, this is for everything.
Hallelujah. You're being really nice this morning.
All right. So Bluetooth is the next thing we wanted to talk to you about. So we really are excited about what you can do when you control Bluetooth peripherals. And along the same lines, we think it's really important to support ZeroConf / Bonjour. I really like the old name. So much better than Bonjour, but what can you do? We're rolling out support for these two. So we frankly appreciate your patience as we've been working on these, and we're excited to roll them out. And we just wanted to tell you a little bit about what's coming because we're really excited to be working on some of these technologies. There's actually one other thing we wanted to talk to you about along these lines, and that has to do with how you develop across different applications. We talked about Mojo and how Mojo sort of provides a mobile-friendly GUI toolkit and other facilities that makes it really easy to create great applications. But what happens when you want to deploy your application to more platforms out there than just ours? A lot of people do things like this, where if you target another mobile platform, which one is this?
It's like
a Nokia, I think this may be the MAMO platform or something. But this is actually HTML styled to look like this native platform. One approach you can do when you try to target other platforms is to take your HTML and style it to look like the platform you're targeting. Or you can take an approach that this application called ConvertBot does, and you can create a whole UI flavor that's really your own, that doesn't really look like it's home on any one particular platform. And so in this case, it could just as easily be deployed on our platform, for example. And so as you figure out a cross-platform story, there's a lot of different ways to approach it. But right now, we feel like we can do more to help you. And so we have a couple of technologies that we're rolling out along these lines, one of which is called Mojo Core, and the other is enhanced HTML5 support, which comes across as the HTML5 geolocation API, local storage, and app cache. And these are really important because they make it really easy for you to build your applications in such a way where you can distribute them across multiple platforms really easily.
So should we chat about Mojo Core?
Should we get to that right now? We did the slide. Why don't we? So it lets you use really easily use other frameworks like jQuery and Sprout Core. And then there's another library we're talking about today called PhoneGap. PhoneGap plays an important role in this ecosystem because PhoneGap finds all the little differences in the web implementations that are out there. And more than that, it'll actually create JavaScript APIs in cases where the JavaScript APIs don't exist in other platforms, and they let you create a web application that can easily be deployed in different environments. And so we have Brian LaRue from PhoneGap here.
Yes, who, indeed. He's over there.
Brian, do you like the...
we found the most flattering picture possible.
We'll be talking about it. But first, we wanted to show you a little bit more about what Mojo Core looks like.
Yeah. So I'm really excited about Mojo Core. And let's get TextMate over here. So before we were talking about how Mojo gives you this nice component model, and it gives you the nice look and feel, and all of these great things for you to build applications that feel right on our platform, and things that you just kind of need as you build applications. But we also know that a lot of people, especially in the cross-platform world, they just want to be able to build a web app that looks and feels like the normal web app they've built that isn't using Mojo itself. It's just using any libraries they want and have that work nicely. So that's where Mojo Core comes in. This is the simplest possible example of an application. We've got a index.html, and all we have to do right now, so the API is subject to change, and we want to get feedback from you guys. Right now, you load in the Mojo Core framework, and then you can make everything scrollable, so it does the bouncy thing as you move things around, or you could actually use this API to just make one div scrollable within. But other than that, this is just typical HTML, and we could put JavaScript in, CSS. You're just taking your normal app, and you just have the ability to kind of get access to this enhanced object to do Mojo-type things. So you could do a test to see if this object exists, and then do Mojo stuff. You know you're on webOS. Otherwise, you're on another platform, and you can keep going. To package it up, we just have the good old app info that's the same thing, and that's all you need to package up that application. So there's no app directory with model view controller stuff and all of the things that you get with Mojo. It's much, much lighter weight. Another example of this, just to show it, is we've got this videos gallery. And we've got an example that shows how you can use any library you want. In this case, we've got jQuery and Dojo and the like. And we happen to put it in this app directory. But just here's an example of doing a check for a particular object here, and now we're going to go through and talk through to that service bus. So again, we can progressively enhance, or you can progressively enhance your standard web application to do more things on our platform. So, I'm running in this environment, I'm going to be able to use notifications, right, and all of the different things that we make available. This is really exciting because, again, we're trying to deliver on this cross-platform story. Reason why we brought Brian in from Notobi and PhoneGap is to kind of share what's going on there so you guys can see that you can build applications. You're not building Palm applications. You're building mobile web applications that you can deploy in a lot of different places. We really believe in raising the bar for the mobile web as a whole. And so this technology gives you a very, very easy way to just take your current web app, make it work on mobile, and then deploy it into different areas using technology like PhoneGap. So again, really want to hear your thoughts on what you'd like to see in the Mojo Core area, because we're actively working on this.
So to be clear, we think if you want to create an application for our platform and target exclusively our platform, Mojo gives you a fantastic way to do that really quickly. And we show you how to architect the application, where to put all your files. We give you an MVC architecture that we think is really elegant. But when you want to create a cross-platform application, we really wanted to deliver a solution that brings a lot of the benefits of Mojo, but still makes it easy to run that in other environments and to use frameworks that are going to be present on those other environments. And so that's what Mojo Core is all about. All right, so we've been talking about the web and a lot of the stuff in our web stack that excites us. We want to talk about the PDK for a few minutes. PDK we announced earlier this year. PDK is a couple of things for us. The first thing the PDK is a way for people who have existing C and C++ code and derivatives to bring that code to our platform without having to recode it from scratch. And right after we announced the web platform back in our earliest days, people would come up to us nonstop at events like this and say, hey, you know, web, that's great, but when can I get like C access to your SDK? And we realized that was a big demand out there. And as we've rolled the PDK out to early partners, we found that people are able to take their C and C++ games in many times, and just after a few hours to a few days of work, boom, they've got it working on our platform. We have countless examples of this. The latest one is, one of the later ones, is a game by Ancient Workshop, the guys who have this game called Ancient Frog that you may have seen on other platforms, and he brought it over to our platform in literally like a day. And so that was one of our drivers for the PDK, is to provide that on-ramp. And that's one of our, I think, core philosophies here at Palm, is that we're really not overly religious, I think, about the developer platforms that you use, and we're really anxious to provide multiple on-ramps to you as developers.
And I think I think we have a talk on that in section 331 at 3:31.
Or was it at 3:31 in the afternoon?
3:31 in the afternoon.
Yeah, anyway. So that's one of the key benefits of the PDK. Another key benefit of the PDK that excites us is what we call hybrid mode. So if you look at the web has used plugins since its earliest days, since the Shockwave multimedia days, evolving into Flash. And plugins have really always been there to augment what's possible. But they've always come with a big problem. Like, why haven't you, as web developers, if you've been a web developer in industry, why haven't you been able to use a plugin before? What's the classic reason why you can't use it? Installation. Is deployment. Is the plugin available? And there's really only one plugin out there that has enough ubiquity for you to be able to say, well, if I wanted to use it, I could. And that's obviously Flash. Flash is like out there in 95% of installs is, I think, the number they give. And so that's really what's hampered plugins, is you've never been able to count on them being there. With the PDK, we thought, geez, wouldn't it be interesting if we were able to give you plugins and you could package those up with your application? And so that's what we're doing, and that's what this hybrid mode that we talk about, and we have a session on that a little later today, is it's the ability for you to package plugins with your application, because we really want to give you the ability to extend the web environment that we've created in whatever way you really want to. And so we think that's really going to be transformational in what it enables, and we're really excited to see what happens when developers start to share these PDK plugins with each other, that sort of go in new directions and take the web in all kinds of new places. And so that's what the PDK is all about. We actually have a PDK session that talks about 3D, because we have OpenGLES 1.1 and 2.0 on the platform, the latest and greatest in mobile 3D, and the PDK gives you access to that, and we have a session that specializes in that today. We also have a 2D graphics library called SDL that we're talking about in a session, and then we have a session devoted to this hybrid mode that I've been talking about. So we're excited about the role that the PDK plays in the ecosystem. We also wanted to take a quick minute and talk to you in general about how to deploy apps. We've been spending a lot of time about building the apps, but we wanted to talk about sort of the marketplace ecosystem dynamics that we have.
One more thing on the PDK. Are we getting a beta to these guys like in the next couple of weeks?
No, we're not.
Oh, okay.
That's right.
So yeah, you should expect in the next couple of weeks, it's really almost done, a beta that's going to have, you know, the bits that will make it available for you to, again, really kind of test them and work this stuff out, getting ready for the deployment of the PDK runtime that's also coming along pretty quickly too.
Yeah, because right now we have the PDK beta that you have in your hands if you want it, but we're giving you now, in a couple of weeks, the beta OS release that will include PDK support for end users. And so you'll be able to test that and see if your apps run in that environment. So I think most of you probably know this if you're familiar with us by now. We have a couple of different ways to distribute apps on the platform. We have the Palm App Catalog, which is pretty traditional, I think, for mobile environments, where we have a reviewed environment, and it's our primary distribution channel on the phone. But what's a little different with us is that we actually have feeds of this catalog that are available that you can look at, XML feeds, and you can analyze them, you can create your own catalogs, and do really interesting things. We want to be as transparent as possible there. But we also have the web distribution channel. And the web distribution channel gives you a way to get applications in users' hands with no review process instantly. And you can optionally keep your application in the web channel in the data feed. So if you want to distribute an application sort of and not tell the world about it, you can. And you can use our infrastructure to deploy that application. But in the spirit of sort of giving you a peek at the future, we wanted to talk to you today a bit about the future of what we're going to do with our distribution. And one of the things we're going to be talking about is our plans for the app catalog. These are sort of in-flight plans. These aren't. This is a consumer-facing feature that we don't want to talk to you about the specific release date of, but we wanted to talk a little bit about our in-flight efforts to make our app catalog have more features than it has today. And we have a session that's going to go into detail about this with Joe Hayashi a little bit later today. So to learn more about our plans for the app catalog and the app ecosystem in general and how to optimize your performance there, I encourage you to hit that session. We also wanted to highlight a program that we have going on right now called Hot Apps.
Yeah. So Hot Apps, you probably are aware of the program. It's our way to give back to the community as you're building these applications and reward the better apps that are out there, but also a whole slew of the great applications that you guys have provided. We put $1 million in the kitty. The program's still running. It's going until June 30th, and there's really still time. We built this dashboard that we'll see in a second that really shows you that you've got time to put new apps into the system right now and do really well, because we reward a lot of people. There's these different ranges of split between free and paid applications, and then the top winner is going to win 100,000, then we've got 20 on each side winning 10,000, and then 200 on each winning 1,000. And go and take a peek at the Hot Apps leaderboard and see who you want to target and get your application in there. Again, as you go down, you'll see that we show the movers and shakers, and there's a lot of movement going on in the catalog right now. And so there's a lot of time for you guys to get in and do really well in this program. Just released on the website yesterday a kit that allows you to kind of put these different widgets on your site to promote your own applications, promote the program itself. This way you can help yourself as much as possible by getting the word out to help yourself in the program. And we've added different social features like integrating into Twitter as part of these widgets too. All of this work was done by Joshua Marinacci, who gave the tutorial yesterday. We appreciate his work there.
So as we wrap up here, wanted to also talk to you about one other feature we have here at the event that we hope is really valuable to you. We have the Apps Lab running, and we have this room back there where we have a schedule posted, and we have a bunch of different developers who are going to be in there. Because one of the focuses that we have at the event is just an opportunity for us to just talk and for us to understand what you want out of the platform, what you're up to, and for you to provide feedback to us, and for us to also engage with you and talk to you about what we're doing and what we're up to. And so we've got everyone from HI engineers to PDK engineers to our core application engineers to some of our DTS guys, our developer tech support guys over there. And so we really want you to take advantage of that. The schedule's posted. And so bring your laptop, bring your applications in there, bring all your questions, and sit down with us and ask us any issues that you may have.
Yeah, and on the agenda itself, there's a real diversity. There's the sessions from Joe Hayashi talking about the business side of how you guys can make money. There's kind of application level, how you build great apps. But then we've also got people like Greg Simon, one of our principal core architects, talking about the nuts and bolts and the low-level stuff. So if you really want to understand how WebOS works, that's a great talk for you too. So really take a look and see what's out there. We tried to provide a real broad range of content kind of shoved into two tracks today. And can't wait to get your feedback on the content and really open up communication in both directions.
And just one final other housekeeping announcement before we wrap up. We have store open, the Palm store open with a 30% discount there in the back. I think that'll be open till noon. So you can head over there. And finally, listen, we are super excited about the web and where the web is headed. We're super excited about being built on the web platform, and we're really excited about what we have today, what we're about to come out with the new PDK beta in just a couple of weeks, and what we're going to get into consumers' hands for PDK stuff, and we're really excited about what we're doing in the mobile web platform in the days to come. And we're excited about what this enables, and we think it's really transformational in its capabilities. Thank you for coming here today. And we really hope that we can spend some time and engage with you and help understand what your needs are and talk to you about how to take advantage of our platform. So thank you very much, and let's have a great day.
Thanks a lot, guys.